This video is brought to you by Captivating History. Africa, the cradle of civilization, was home to the first of our species. Its continent held some of the greatest early societies on Earth, and we are now rediscovering the amazing scope of the history in this ancient land. Home of the pharaohs, Queen Sheba, Hannibal Barca, and Mansa Musa, the rich tapestry of Africa's past is still being explored and uncovered today. The Middle Nile regions of Africa was a highly sought-after area and the subject of many conflicts between Egypt and Nubia, as it was an important trade route. From the 16th to the 11th century BCE, Egypt's new kingdom was able to keep Nubia pacified to expand its influence over territories in modern-day Syria. Around 1650 BCE, the Kerma kingdom gained power in Lower Nubia and controlled trade between Egypt and Africa. Egyptians called Nubia the Kingdom of Kush, and the people of this region were known as Kushites. No records remain of the early Kushites, other than as enemies of the Egyptians. The earliest mention of the Kingdom of Kush is that Kamoz of the 17th dynasty of Egypt had fought them during his reign from 1555 to 1500 BCE. Kamoz was able to secure Lower Nubia, but could not expand Egypt further south. His successor, Ahmose I, continued the conquest. In 1460 BCE, during the reign of Thutmose III, Egypt finally managed to control territories down to the fourth cataract of the Nile. The cataracts of the Nile are parts of the river that are unnavigable due to rapids, shallows, or waterfalls. Originally, there were six, and they represented natural borders. Nubia stretched from the first to the fourth cataract. Despite evident Egyptian influence, the people of this region also practiced their own rites and religions. These lands were under Egyptian control from 1550 to 1096 BCE, but not entirely, as there were many rebellions. From 1401 to 1390 BCE, during the reigns of Thutmose IV and Ramses III, every ruler had to fight the locals to keep control. The Kingdom of Kush was rich in gold, so one theory is that conflicts arose over control of their gold mines. Under Ramses XI, 1098 to 1069, the Egyptians were suffering economic decline and withdrew from Nubia. Their influence steadily declined until around 750 BCE, and although the pharaohs continued to try and regain the lost territories, they instead had to establish trade in place of control. As most of the history of this region comes from Egyptian texts, once they left the area, things become obscure. We know that between the 11th and 8th centuries BCE, local systems of government emerged. The Kushites traded with the Egyptians and Ethiopians, as evidenced in the tombs of the chiefs. Queen Amanipalade, who ruled from 308 to 320 CE, was the last known leader of the Kingdom of Kush, although Kush continued to exist for decades after her death. It is unknown why the kingdom collapsed, but economic fall and warfare are likely to have had a part in it. After Kush's collapse, the Nubians founded Nubatia, Elodia, and Makuria under a new religion that Egypt had adopted, Christianity. Another kingdom lost to antiquity is the land of Punt. Again, Egyptian texts are our only source of knowledge about this lost civilization. The Egyptians give us various details about Punt, which has led scholars to believe that its location was in the Horn of Africa, most likely in modern-day Somalia and Ethiopia, although the exact geographical location is still a mystery. The Puntites were ruled by their own royal family, although the only names that have survived are King Parahu and Queen Ati, who reigned in the time of Hatshepsut, 1507 to 1458 BCE. During Pharaoh Pepi II's reign, a governor named Harkuf documents how he brought a dancing pygmy slave from the Puntites as a gift for the king. Harkuf got the idea from the Puntites, who had brought an earlier pharaoh the same present. It has been much debated whether or not these slaves were true pygmies or Puntites with dwarfism. A recent study of modern Egyptians discovered a significant number of people with BM60 haplotype in their paternal lineage. The DNA haplogroup, found in the pygmies of Central Africa, was not found in ancient Egyptians or Sudanese, which led researchers to believe that Egyptians with this haplotype are descended from the pygmy slaves. Evidence in Egyptian texts shows that ancient Egyptians thought differently about Punt than other foreign lands. Given the links with religious deities and culture, many historians believe the Egyptians originated from Punt. DNA testing proved this idea, showing that the inhabitants of Somalia, Eritrea, Ethiopia, and Sudan are the ancient Egyptians' linear ancestors. The city of Carthage cultivated its own legendary beginning. The story of Dido, spurned sister of Pygmalion, and her quest for a land of her own is first mentioned centuries after the founding of the famous city. The myth may have originated from lost facts, but we do know that Carthage was a major trading point connecting Spain, the Levant, Tyre, Italy, and Greece. During the 8th century BCE, Carthage prospered and was ran by the wealthy merchants who traded there. In 573 BCE, the fall of the Kingdom of Tyre allowed Carthage to expand. Although this is sometimes depicted as an aggressive expansion, in reality, it was mainly through trade. Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had defeated Tyre, and silver had been devalued due to overabundance, leading to Tyre's economic decline. Trade in Carthage was diverse enough to survive the economic downturn. Aside from a couple of aggressions, Carthage continued to develop its trade routes and settlements through alliance and commerce. During the 330s BCE, an influential figure emerged from Greece. Alexander the Great dominated the known world, and the Carthaginians felt he was sure to attack them as soon as he had the chance. Alexander died without reaching Carthage, leaving his commanders to divide his empire between them. One of these commanders led a failed attack on Carthage and paid for it with his son's life. Carthage traded by sea and had a well-developed navy. In the 3rd century BCE, Carthage started to expand more aggressively. During the Punic Wars, they invaded Spain, where they founded New Carthage, now Cartagena. Hannibal Barca famously led his men and war elephants across the Alps and into Italy. Hannibal spent 15 years fighting Rome, receiving no aid from his native Carthage and recruiting the locals as soldiers. In 202 BCE, Carthage learned of an imminent attack from Rome and called Hannibal to their defense. A bloody battle ensued, in which the Carthaginians suffered 10 times the losses of their enemies. Although defeated, Carthage continued to exist until 146 BCE, when the Romans finally broke Carthage's defenses and burned the city to the ground. Citizens were enslaved, and a century later, Julius Caesar would rebuild the city as the new Roman center in Africa. Another African kingdom well-positioned for trade was the Kingdom of Aksum. The kingdom was located in Ethiopia and controlled the narrow strait joining the Red Sea to the Gulf of Aden. This position wasn't just beneficial for trade, it also had abundant rainfall, fertile soil, and it is assumed they were capable of producing more than one harvest per year. Who founded the kingdom remains a mystery, but legend has it that the Queen of Sheba ruled from the city of Aksum. Many of Aksum's tales include biblical figures, although it is unknown whether they came with Christianity in the 4th century CE or from earlier Jewish influences. Based on writings from that period and archaeological evidence, Aksum was most likely established around the 1st century CE. Greek polymath Claudius Ptolemy wrote of Aksum in 150 CE, at the beginning of the 3rd century. Aksum expanded into what is now known as Yemen and took control of any trade ships accessing the Red Sea. The decline of Aksum happened during the 8th and 9th centuries CE. Besides costly ongoing wars in Yemen, the climate had begun to change. Climatic evidence suggests that the rainfall dropped significantly, meaning the population could no longer be self-sustaining. Lands that were once fertile were abandoned as people emigrated south. Coastal territories of the Red Sea were lost to the Rashidun Caliphate, and the city of Aksum was abandoned. Arabic sources called the kingdom Habashat. With a declining economy, the people of Aksum stopped producing coins and started using cloth and salt for bartering. Losing coastal positions isolated Aksum, and as a Christian kingdom amid Islamic states, it was cut off by religion and trade. Aksum continued to be mentioned in historic texts until the 10th century, but it never regained the glory of its heyday. Despite the changing balance of power, the people remained the same, and the Aksumite influence can still be seen today in modern Ethiopia. The Empire of Ghana has little to do with modern-day Ghana. Originally, it was called Wagadu, and their ruler's official title was Ghana. Wagadu was located in a landlocked area 100 miles north of the River Niger, territories which now belong to western Mali and southeastern Mauritania. The origins of Wagadu have been passed down through strong oral tradition. This tradition speaks of a common ancestor to the Saninki people, Dinga, and his two sons, all nomads. So the Saninki are not just found in one place. Legend has it that Dinga fought a magical battle with spirits inhabiting an area in modern-day Mali. After defeating the spirits, he married their daughters and had lots of sons, who became leaders of the Saninki clans. Upon Dinga's death, his youngest son, Diabe Sise, tricked Dinga into passing him his chiefly powers. Diabe Sise then had to hide from his elder brother, who was the rightful successor. Diabe Sise hid in the wilderness, where he found a magic drum that, when beaten, summoned four cavalry commanders from the four sides of the world. These commanders became the chiefs of the four provinces of the Wagadu Kingdom. Diabe Sise and his followers settled on the land of a giant python called Bida. Bida demanded a beautiful girl as a yearly sacrifice. One year, the fiancé of the chosen girl cut off the python's head. As Bida died, he cursed the kingdom with drought and lack of gold, and the kingdom split into four different clans. While some parts of this tale may be fanciful, climate change may indeed have led to the decline of the Wagadu Kingdom. By the 13th century, the kingdom no longer existed. While Wagadu declined, the Mali Empire was rising. The most famous ruler of the Mali Empire was Mansa Musa of the Keita clan. He ruled for 25 years, from 1312 to 1337, and his reign was considered a golden age for the people of Mali. A generous ruler, Musa inherited his throne after his predecessor journeyed across the Atlantic and never returned. Mansa Musa certainly had style. Reports tell of him sitting on a throne made of ebony and elephant tusks. Musa and his officials wielded weapons made of gold when meeting with representatives from other kingdoms, and Musa had a slave hold over him a silk sunshade adorned with a gold falcon. He had musical accompaniment whenever he was out in public. Instead of making any public announcements personally, he would whisper to his chief spokesman, who made the announcements for him. As a devout Muslim, Musa embarked on a pilgrimage to Mecca. He planned his departure carefully by consulting soothsayers and arrived in Egypt in 1324. The journey had taken a year. Musa's people were dressed in the finest silks, and it is said that each of his 12,000 slaves carried a gold bar. Once in Egypt, he sold all the slaves and gifted the money to the Egyptians. He stayed in Egypt before continuing to the Holy Land. His return journey was strained, but he still managed to annex Timbuktu and Gao to make them part of the Mali Empire. Around 1337, Musa's son became the new king, although it is unknown exactly how Musa died. Africa's history is far from complete. As the birthplace of humanity, Africa's human history is the longest and most complex of any continent on Earth. Historians are still learning about this incredible land. In the coming years, who knows what other cultures may be discovered under the shifting sands of the Sahara? To learn more about ancient Africa, check out our book, Ancient Africa, A Captivating Guide to the Ancient African Civilizations, such as the Kingdom of Kush, the Land of Punt, Carthage and the Kingdom of Aksum, and the Mali Empire with its Timbuktu. It's available as an ebook, paperback, and audiobook. Also, grab your free Mythology Bundle ebook while it's still available. All links are in the description. If you enjoyed the video, please hit the like button and subscribe for more videos like this.